There's no Skrelv on the battlefield, and that'll give Greg a chance of victory.
All right, it's time for some more quarterfinals here at World Championship 29. I'm going to pass it on over to Ailey and Corey.
Thank you so much, Maria and Moni. We are in for another absolute cracker here in the quarterfinals of the Magic World Championship. I'm Ailey Loney alongside Corey Baumeister, and we are in for a treat in this matchup. It is going to be Esper up against a homebrew, a Greg Pyle, in Bent Control. Corey, what do you predict in this matchup?
You know, if John Emmanuel Dupras says that he likes this matchup thanks to Thalia, I'm going to go with that, but I would never count out Greg playing a control deck. This deck looked awesome every time we saw it throughout the weekend as well. Up the Beanstalk, I've never seen a better list in Standard that's playing it, so I think this is just going to be a close one, and I'm really excited to see who advances to the semifinals.
Yeah, so many awesome ways to trigger up the Beanstalk in Greg's list. The Syncopates, the March of Otherworldly Lights, alongside all the regular suspects you'd expect to see in this, you know, and the Hornlocked Whale. Hornlocked Whale, excuse me. That's such a cool inclusion, too. I love seeing it here.
I'm starting to think Greg likes to draw cards.
I think so.
I think it might be true.
All right, and I'm going to kick things off here with Fairy Mastermind for Jean-Emmanuel Dupras. So didn't get the 1-2 punch start that he, you know, perhaps would have liked. Skrelv into Athalia to protect the card that taxes Greg's list the most.
Yep, but Jean-Emmanuel just saying, you know what, I do not want this to get syncopated or make disappeared. Mm-hmm. So just playing it main phase here to avoid that.
Yeah, it's always interesting when you know that you have instant speed spells and your opponent is playing control and counter spells aplenty. So,
yeah, you just want your stuff to resolve at that point.
Definitely just get it on the board when you can and make them deal with it thereafter.
And we do see two syncopates there in hand for Greg, as well as land three, March, Sunfall, and the Wandering Emperor. So a very solid hand. Just going to have to be able to deal with these Fairy Masterminds. A great card against Up the Beanstalk.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my.
Such a great card here. So two Fairy Masterminds going to start chipping in for big chunks of damage as this game progresses. So Greg is going to hope to get to land number five shortly and get these creatures off the board.
Yeah, and we saw a March there. We see Leyline Binding as well. Now, this is nice. This is well-timed here by Greg, playing it on John Emmanuel's turn, so you just draw the one, doesn't trigger the Fairy Mastermind. That's going to be really a big tension point of this game, is playing around that draw ability from the Fairy's Mastermind.
This is an Esper Legends deck, and you know the way that this card has been performing, it may well be a legend in and of itself.
Yeah, pretty
just
much.
No legend rule.
It's a Legends card.
Oh, sure.
Takahashi, absolute legend.
Absolutely.
So we did see the activation from Fairy Mastermind here. John Emmanuel valuing drawing three cards here instead of advancing to the battlefield. Mm-hmm. I like that play quite a bit.
That's a restock in the hand. See plenty of lands for Greg Orange. It's a Wandering Emperor there. Spar's Headquarters to double syncopates, like you mentioned.
So might just go for the main phase Wandering Emperor here and get rid of Fairy Mastermind. That is an option.
Seems like a good one.
Yeah, I like that quite a bit. You can also just march the Fairy Mastermind. You don't get to double spell that way.
Yeah.
It would cost three mana anyways unless you pitch a card from your hand. So I like just playing this right here and then. There's not really any haste threats, or not really as in there are zero haste threats that can threaten the Wandering Emperor here. So John Emmanuel Dupras' play of drawing, activating Fairy Mastermind came with a cost because now cannot pressure this Wandering Emperor.
Yeah, Wandering Emperor on the board is a great place to be for Greg Orange, playing Band Control. And now we're going to see Lord Skitter, Sewer King on the board, making a couple rats, and Denik, Pious Apprentice, joining the Sewer King.
And I think there's land five and Sunfall. Sunfall, draw a card, incubate three, and then tick up on the Wandering Emperor is a great play here against JD.
Yeah, no Thalia to speak of to tax Greg Orange, put him back a turn. And he is certainly in the driver's seat in this first game here for these players.
Yep, and Greg in his element going to six cards, passing the turn.
Yep.
You know, I don't know if there's a rumor that he's never had less than six cards in his hand.
Oh.
Yeah, ever.
Okay.
Yeah, it's impressive.
Draw for turn, another land for Greg Orange. Can cycle away these triomes, these tri-lands if needs be. It's going to turn to the Wandering Emperor and create a samurai.
just the pass from JED. You got to think there's going to be some flash threats here, maybe an Urtai available.
Nothing of the sort, unfortunately. Just goes to his draw.
Must be really flooded here because Esper Legend is definitely a deck that just wants to get on the battlefield often and, you know, at a wide
fast
battlefield pace. Yeah.
Absolutely. So nothing of the sort yet for Jean Emmanuel. Rebuilding as best he can. So Lord Skitter back down on the board. And let's see if we can get some rats going here.
Yep. And exiles that. Now is able to march.
Yeah.
For the full amount to make sure to draw another card.
I love that. It's such a versatile way to get cards off of the beanstalk. It's like, I've got nothing else to do. I would like a card, so I'm just going to overpay.
Exactly.
Ticking up on the Emperor, getting the counter on the Samurai. In for three. So JED down to 17. I must say, I'm so happy to see Jean-Emmanuel back on top eight Sunday. You know, he had an absolutely blistering run a couple of years back where it just wasn't top eight Sunday without Jean-Emmanuel. And then he's just been quietly consistent up until yesterday when we were all just like, oh, wait, Jean-Emmanuel made it. I spoke to him after the event and he's like, yeah, I didn't think I was going to. And I'm so glad you're here. So.
Yeah, whenever you start with a few losses and then start rattling off the wins at the end, we don't see you a lot on coverage
until you
just sneak right in. But one of the best Magic players on the tour right now.
Go for the third, takes care of the Samurai with a counter on it. So the board is now clear of creatures except for this lowly little rat.
Yeah, and looks like we have some Syncopates in hand, a Dissipate, Memory Deluge, and another Up the Beanstalk, so no shortage of action here from Greg.
Yeah, Rona Herald of the Invasion now for Jean-Emmanuel. I was almost expecting to see an Agatha's Soul Cauldron. Like, no, wait, not that deck.
Made it very close. Ninth place for a Cauldron Rona Brew special.
So this Wandering Emperor is sticking around. Is going to be a problem for Jean-Emmanuel. The longer this game goes, the more it advantages Greg Orange.
For sure. And the thing about these kind of matchups here is, well, when Greg Orange brings this kind of brew to the tournament, you know who has a lot of practice against this style of deck?
No one.
No one, exactly. But Greg has so much practice against Esper Legends, Esper Midrange, the rest of the top eight. So there is value to be gained there. It is open decklist, of course, so these players can get a good idea. They're great enough players that they can adapt on the fly.
Oh, sure.
But that is not nothing, that's for sure.
Frank Carsten released some metagame data, and Greg Orange's band control was 7-1 versus the other archetypes in the top eight.
Wow.
Yeah, so you got to think he must be pretty pleased with his decision or his choice this weekend.
Yeah, Greg's deck has looked incredible.
Look at all these goodies we're finding. Another Wandering Emperor, Lay Down Arms, couple of lands.
And a interaction there. You know, at first you see five cards off a Memory Deluge and you want to call a judge.
Yeah.
Have no fear because Thalia taxes it and that does increase the extra card because it is mana spent to cast the card. Yep. An interesting thing.
Hey, that's sweet. Thanks, Thalia. Not supposed to be helping me here. And her usefulness for Greg Orange is now done.
There you go.
As Lay Down Arms is going to take care of the Cathar.
And Greg still holding back with a couple of counter spells here. Syncopate 4/4 here is going to be great in the face of three mana available for Rafine. And why not? I'll draw a card as well.
Yeah. And there's only one main deck copy of a counterspell for Jean-Emmanuel, you know, non-creature based. So just that single copy of Make Disappear does have the two Urtai to help resolve or keep spells around, but in this case, didn't have access to it.
Yeah, Monty was saying maybe Esper Legends can be looked at as a little bit of a one-dimensional deck, and it is in the sense that you have to play creatures, you know, with Thalia being a four of in your main deck, you can't play a lot of spells, but all the creatures do so many unique spell-like things.
Sure.
With Urtai, you know, with Skrelv protecting, plenty of other examples as well that you really don't need to play spells, you just have creatures that take that role as well.
And at the end of most games, you know, power and toughness is going to be what wins it for you.
Yeah.
As Skrelv is taken care of.
I think it's going to be whales that win, Greg, the most things here. Yeah, whenever you see Greg attacking, that's a good indicator that he's winning the game. You know, Greg does not attack very often until it is time to close things out. So,
oh yeah,
if you're looking, life totals maybe not the best indicator of who is ahead.
Oh,
it's usually when Greg attacks that's kind of getting it done.
That's signifying the beginning of the end here for Jean-Emmanuel, as two Horned Lochwales are going in for 14 points of damage. Down to two goes JED. Let's see what the top of the library has for us. These creatures can't block, so taking down the Wandering Emperor. Greg Orange doesn't need that powerful planeswalker anymore.
Yep, and all but over here.
GG to the Citrus Assassin in the first game here. A reminder that this is best 3 of 5, so you can see the progress above and below their country flags. So let's go to game number 2, Corey.
Absolutely, and a reminder to everyone, we begin sideboarding after this game.
Sure.
We play 2 pre-boarded, and then the last 3 would be the post-board.
Yeah, just to give both players the opportunity to be on the play. Hey, that's a good start. Skrelv, Defector Might on board first here. Let's see if he can follow up with a Thalia, Guardian of Thraben.
And a mulligan there from JED down to 6 cards on the play. But yeah, Thalia is definitely the follow-up you want here.
Yeah.
Whenever you have to pay 3 for that up the beanstalk, it is really, really brutal. The card that's really going to be the great answer is something like Lay Down Arms.
Yeah.
There is 4 of those for Greg. But Skrelv attacking leads me to believe we don't have Thalia here.
Alrighty, Fairy Mastermind, though.
Yeah, I mean, now...
Decent follow-up.
It is decent. It's a little interesting to me to not... or to attack with Skrelv, because right now, Greg has the option to Lay Down Arms on Fairy Mastermind.
Oh,
but decides not to.
Yeah, just passes the turn back, so Skrelv and Fairy Mastermind sitting pretty at the moment.
Yep.
We've got to make disappear, we've got to Lay Down Arms, a couple extra lands in hand there for Greg. I appreciate him fanning.
Agreed. Yep.
Habitually.
It does look like has the march for Skrelv and then could untap and exile a creature as well. So maybe looking to line that up.
Oh, hey, Rafine, Scheming Seer attempts to sneak by here, but nope, make disappear. Rafine has disappeared from the board.
And a great play there by Greg, not Lay Down Armings, just in case Rafine were to hit the battlefield.
Yeah. That's definitely the bigger threat of the 3 that are present here for Jean-Emmanuel Duprat. Land go from Greg Orange. We're going to see that quite a lot in this matchup. Let's see what the follow-up is here for JED.
3 mana. There is the Lord.
Syncopate takes care of Lord Skittlesewer King. He's not hanging around much.
And I think maybe I saw, possibly that was an Agonjo in hand, maybe JED holding on to that instead of playing it.
Got Myrix, Jemir's Garden. Plenty of removal for Greg Orange, so we'll have to turn his attention to these creatures on the board eventually.
Yep.
But for the time being, Skrelv is on protect duty, while Fairy Mastermind is very much attack.
Absolutely. And it looks like, yeah, a lot of spot removal. I think there's a Sunfall as well. So it'll be the choice. Does Greg want to try to get the most value and, you know, not deal with any creatures and try to Sunfall or pick them off one at a time here? Decides to fire that off. Up the Beanstalk's got to be a great draw.
Oh, yeah. Going to get to 5 lands very shortly and then big spell time. But first things first, let's Lay Down Arms, get rid of Fairy Mastermind. So nothing on the board at the moment for Jean-Emmanuel. Up the Beanstalk, we'll draw a card here for Greg. Okay. So Rafine's Tower, drawn off the top.
Now JED really needs to get a threat that is meaningful on the battlefield. Fairy Mastermind, Rafine, even Thalia would be decent. But Greg's deck is just all card draw, all removal, and this feels like this could really be a tough matchup for JED, at least pre-board.
You know, for sure.
Post-board, you get to convert some of these not-so-great creatures into a plethora of counter spells, maybe Wedding Announcements, stuff like that.
All right, nice. So, flashing in Urtai, not destroying anything.
Yep.
But it is a threat.
Yeah, absolutely. Just anything to get it going.
Yeah.
And now with that march in hand that I believe we saw from Greg, Greg could fire this off right now, mm-hmm. could go with the Aganjo, that's uncounterable, or just wait till end step to see what he casts.
Yeah, just paying the full price yet again. Yep. You know, do you have the one copy of Make Disappear? Yeah. Let's see.
And even if you do, it's not that brutal when you get to redraw a card off all these removal spells. So cool.
Not at all.
Up the beanstalk.
It's so sweet. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you see it in the domain list. You see it here in band control. Like, green is worth a splash for plenty of these players. I mean, we saw a Sultai Fairies list submitted.
Yes.
Where it was just a mirror deck splashing for the green lands. So it's like, yes. Okay, so green is good.
Yeah, Shota having a really cool list there. Definitely worth checking out. And we see it in so many different formats as well. Like, this may be the best card in the set. You know, I would not be shocked if it ends up being the most impactful here in a couple weeks.
It's a Horned Loch Whale on an adventure.
All right, looks like we got a Skrelv there.
Yep. Urtai's off the board. 21 to 12 now. I doubt we'll see anyone dying to poison this weekend, but, you know, stranger things have happened.
You never know. Mirex is an incredible land, and if any deck is going to do it, it's going to be a control deck.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's a Greg Orange control player's dream right there. Be like, think about it. I don't have to play any win cons if I just have a Mirex.
Go for the third. Takes care of the Horned Loch Whale. So it's just a battle of the small but mighty. You see what I did there?
Very nice.
Thank you. Thank you. Thraben Guardian. Thalia, Guardian of Thraben. Now on the board here. I'm going to tax the mana for Greg Orange, but not the worst thing when you have up the beanstalk there.
Yep, this could easily be the Sunfall turn if Greg is getting a little afraid. Doesn't really have any other action, so I think this makes a lot of sense because this is also Greg's card draw spell.
Yeah.
Since it will cost 6, triggering up the beanstalk. Now, Make Disappear, if JED has it, could counter this. Looks like it is not there.
Doesn't have it. Another up the beanstalk, another card. Awesome. So, yeah, Greg is certainly cooking with gas at this point.
Absolutely.
Lead on arms. So, an Aganjo in hand. What else does he have there?
Plenty of gas. All things kind of pointing to Greg Orange looking really good here so far.
Yeah, this Lord Skitter, he is not long for this world. Lead on arms, taking care of that once again.
And just to go for the throat off the top for JED, only has a rat. I mean, you got to think this is pretty much locked up for Greg. This is a control player's dream.
Yeah.
Just at this point where you just get to kind of click buttons at random and do all the things. And I would say, I mean, this is huge advantage to Greg by winning the first two games. But if we, as we just saw the Reed Duke Anthony match, you can never count anyone out when they win the first two. That's for sure.
Definitely not.
Another go for the throat off the top for JED there.
Things looking great so far for the Citrus Assassin. Is this his year to win the World Championship? Look at all those cards we've drawn.
And a little bit of an interesting interaction here that maybe is not the most intuitive is the flashback cost.
Yes.
Still looks at the 4 mana value of Memory Deluge, so you do not draw cards off the beanstalks. Yeah, I bet those Go for the Throats are probably coming out. They deal with whales, but I mean, right now we're going to have 3 creatures on the battlefield, maybe 4, and they're all artifacts. And now even with this whale hitting the battlefield, even if you kill it, you're still, you know, Greg is still drawing two cards, so most of the time when you kill a creature, you know, it's at least a 1-for-1. JED's still getting 2-for-1 with this removal spell, thanks to the powerful enchantment of Up the Beanstalk.
And the rough part is, if you could double spell and kill 2 things, the ward cost on the whale is relevant.
Exactly.
So, sitting in 5 lands, unable to deal with both of those big creatures, so going to take a big chunk of damage down to 10 and 6 poison. Maybe we will see a poison.
There we go.
Well, the whales may have something to say about it.
Yeah, if anything, it's looking like a win. Maybe poison and life total hitting 0 basically at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
And, I mean, as it stands right now, we did see that other go for the throat. Or Odawara there.
All right. Get rid of the incubated token.
Looks like going to 1 and 9 poison, the closest to death you can possibly be.
Well, if you had 1 card
one
in the
card
library,
in
yeah,
library.
Yeah,
there
that's
you
like
go.
The trifecta. That's the, oh yeah, you're heckin' dead. So let's see if Jean-Emmanuel draws anything of consequence here. It's Raphine, Scheming Seer.
There's just no coming back from this from JD's deck. Well, you said we're not going to see any poison kills. Well, we see it the same game you mentioned that.
Yeah. I'm prophesizing the opposite into existence
there
here.
You go.
So game three, players are now allowed to sideboard. So let's take a quick look at the player sideboards between you and I here, Corey. What comes in for Jean-Emmanuel to help him fight back in this matchup?
Yeah, so starting with Jean-Emmanuel, we see Negate, Disdainful Stroke, Wedding Announcement. Those are the things that initially jump out to me. There's two the Dawnsky. Sometimes you see that card when it's a slower match, but with all the exile effects from Greg, we're definitely not going to see that one. So I would imagine this just those seven cards, and you're going to see like Go for the Throats being taken out, some of the less impactful creatures as well.
Lovely start here, though, for Jean-Emmanuel, as Skrelv is there to take a March of Otherworldly Light to the face, basically. Raphine Scheming Seer remains for the time being, but does Greg have something in hand to deal with it?
Doesn't look like it at first glance.
Oh, Shark Attack. Yeah.
All right.
Promo Seed Shark.
This is another really great card that Greg has access to three copies in the sideboard, and the kind of the best thing you can be doing that these domain decks have adopted and Greg's Bant control deck have adopted is the Seed Shark with Leyline Binding. Mm-hmm. Even though it costs one, it still incubates for six. So if you ever have four mana and you go Chrome Host Seed Shark and you have domain, play a one mana Leyline Binding, now you can fire up a 6/6 the following turn. Ends up being one of the more impactful starts that you can have from this deck.
Leyline Binding is a hell of a magic card.
Yeah. All right, Raphine getting in there and just looting away some cards. But this feels like about the best start that JED has had so far. Just Raphine doing some hand manipulation makes it a lot better of a spot
for
him than the last two games.
I don't think we saw like any looting at all or you know, extra draws for Jean-Emmanuel. So Greg was certainly in the driver's seat the entirety of those two games. So lots of work here for the Frenchman, as we see Fairy Mastermind hit the board and join the fray here.
Yep.
Alongside Raphine.
And that was in response to the up the beanstalk to be able to get that extra draw trigger here for free.
Nice. Your cards are my cards.
Yeah.
And also my cards.
All right, and I think we saw an Eternal Wanderer picked up here. One of the few copies of that card really in the entire tournament, but
the only one.
Yeah, okay. The Wanderer walks alone.
Well, at least certainly makes anyone attacking her walk alone. It's like,
yeah.
Nope, only one of you can swing this way.
Yeah, powerful card, but six mana is definitely just a lot.
Yeah.
Can be a liability.
Triggers off the beanstalk, though. Oh, you know,
there you go.
Cards.
Yeah. Basically, Greg's entire deck is working with up the beanstalk.
How many expensive things can I realistically cost?
Yeah, you know a green card's got to be really good for Greg to put it in his deck.
Oh, man. So doing some more conniving here is Raphine the Scheming Seer. Skrelv Defector Might joins the Flyers.
Okay. And JED leaving up Plaza of Hero mana as well as could be Urtai, something like that. But it's basically saying JED is like, I'm fine with what I have on the battlefield. I'm going to protect now and stop you from casting the big impactful spells like Sunfall.
Yeah. Sunfall gets around Plaza of Heroes. So he'd need a counterspell, so an Urtai or something.
Exactly.
From the sideboard to counter that would be great.
Urtai, the multiple Urtais, you have the Disdainful Strokes, you have the one of Make Disappear and Negate.
Well,
so,
so
a good amount of things that he could have.
This feels closer.
Very, very. Yeah, the other two games honestly did not feel very competitive.
No.
It wasn't even JED getting close and then Greg coming back. Greg was pretty much in control this entire match so far.
Yeah. And, you know, again, that's that just reiterates the statistics that we saw from Frank Carson being 7-1 up against the other archetypes in the top eight. So.
Yep. So now this is tempting JED to be like, well, you can activate that Plaza if you want.
Nice. Counters an activated ability as well.
There
so
you go.
It's one way to get around the channel lands.
Yeah. You usually don't see that mode of Erdtai actually getting rid of the ability.
Yeah. It's either countering something on the stack or killing something, but
yeah, and JD,
nice to see it useful there.
Agreed. And JD did have the, you know, chance to just Plaza of Hero it, but wants to get something on the battlefield a little bit more.
Yeah, I like that play.
Yeah, it's
hopefully,
a good play.
Hopefully we don't get Sunfold here
exactly.
for Jean-Emmanuel fans, otherwise that could well be the death knell for Jean-Emmanuel.
Yeah.
That all rhymed unintentionally.
You're crushing it.
Oh, yeah, look at me go.
All right, we see Shieldred, Thalia, Odawara, and a Coast in hand there for JED as the four cards. A quick glance there, and yeah, that's...
All right, so Thalia goes bye-bye. I get a counter on the Fairy Mastermind. Chromehost Seed Shark will block Rafine. They just bounce off each other for now. Greg Orange down to 9. This is looking much better for Jean-Emmanuel, so just got to hope that there is no
board
wipe. Got to
be Sunfall on the top, really.
No Sunfall, just a land. So things looking good here for the Frenchman.
Yep. And Sunfall would have been the extremely over-the-top spell to draw here, but Greg still has a functional hand here. Can Wandering Emperor pay the ward, deal with Rafine if you want. I guess Skrull.
Which is the bigger threat at this point? I mean, Rafine is certainly doing the conniving here.
Exactly.
But this Fairy Mastermind, was it a 5 power now?
Exactly. And Skrull is really putting a wrinkle in all of those plans right now. So, yeah, Greg's in a rough spot. Has to piece together something like Wandering Emperor during combat, have JED use Skrull to protect it, and then do something during Greg's turn. But...
I mean, how much power is coming across there? We're likely to see the Wandering Emperor in response to attackers, but then Skrull just gives protection to whatever it targets, right? So you don't gain any life.
Yep, exactly. You don't gain life, basically counters it. The best thing Greg can do here to double spell, essentially, is incubate the 2-2, block Erdtai, and then use the whale's ability to target another creature. That's going to get negated by Skrull. And all of a sudden, we're going to see 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 damage through. This looks like game number 3 going to JED.
Sure does.
Looks like Xaxes.
Nice, yeah. Greg Orange figured it out, too. He's like, well, you do this, I did that. Okay, cool. Next. Game number 4.
Yeah.
That was sweet. That was a very good game there
good
by Jean-Emmanuel.
A much better showcase of the Esper Legend deck that JED brought. And, you know, there is something to say about these post-board games being a little bit better for Esper Legends than they are for Greg. Like, Greg's not changing his deck very drastically.
No.
But JED definitely is. Go for the throat. We saw how terrible it really looked for most of the game. So I would be shocked to see if we see all of them in. Maybe you have one or two to deal with the whale, but then there's the counterplay. Greg might take out the whales because of removal spells. So.
Oh, another ideal start here for Jean-Emmanuel with Thalia, Guardian of Thraben on the board, taxing all of the non-creature spells for Greg Orange, and we can see plenty of them in his hand.
Yep, and we do see another mulligan here for Greg. Greg mulliganed last game as well, so yeah. We might be seeing double reverse sweeps here in the quarterfinals.
We may well. If things keep going like this for Jean-Emmanuel, has his Lord Skitter counted once again by Make Disappear? But... the important part for Greg Orange is that Thalia's off the board, so now everything is the cost it should be.
Yep, and Make Disappear available there. Looks like Leyline Binding as well, and we have Naya and Esper Triomes. So all locked up on Domain for that to cost 1 mana. Now you really want to pair that with Up the Beanstalk.
Yeah.
Greg's deck really looks kind of like night and day different when you have an Up the Beanstalk on turn 2 versus not. Like, otherwise, you're just playing a control deck that can run out of steam very easily. Depending on cards like Memory Deluge and stuff like that, not ideal.
Skrull Defector Might hits the board here alongside another Plaza of Heroes.
And I believe... there's
Erdtai. On the end step.
Yeah, looks like Greg just went draw go there. I would say Greg's signature move, draw go.
Oh, little Skrull.
Okay.
Gonna get got.
So doing this first, you target Skrelv, and now if JED wants to activate Skrelv, mm-hmm. has to do it now, and then Greg can respond to the activation.
To get rid of Urtai.
Exactly. It looks like the whale is kind of the plan for Urtai.
Ah, okay. Nice.
Look at that's the value of Skrelv and how much equity JED yeah. puts on that card. Just sacrificed a land and paid 4 mana. So that would tell me one of a couple of things. One, you know, maybe Skrelv is very, very important. Mm. Two, maybe JED's hand doesn't necessarily have a lot left in the tank and just want to keep around Skrelv for as long as possible.
Yes, it's going to be an attempt here with Leyline Binding.
And this is probably going to be the same thing. Leyline Binding targets Skrelv and then try to deal with Urtai, but yeah. the same thing could happen as well. There's another plaza.
This time Skrelv gets got, so Urtai yeah. is free pickings here for Greg, who's going to send it back with Lagoon Breach. Potentially. What does Jean-Emmanuel have to say about this?
Yep.
So it'll go back on top.
Okay, back on top. And we'll see what the follow-up is.
Dennick Pious Apprentice.
All right, and it looks like, at quick glance, I think I saw Go for the Throat and Odawara in JED's hand. So neither player's hand is really anything special. This is just going to be a grind.
Yep. Just, you know, two power coming across yep. the line every so often.
Yeah, and JED did have the option there when the whale was targeted to Urtai to get rid of that plaza as well, and mm-hmm. that would counter the whale from going to the adventure zone, but
yeah.
decided that was not worth it enough.
I don't think he's drawing lands, if I were to guess.
Yeah. And this whale can't even be cast right now. There's only one mm-hmm. blue source. But the shark is very good, and there is that combination that I was talking about a little bit earlier. Yeah. There's Leyline Binding, so... Now, I believe this is still on the stack, so we'll see if we Urtai this. I think you kind of have to.
Yeah, because we know that there are the 4 full copies of Leyline Binding. Oh, okay. We're sacrificing to make him hexproof and indestructible.
Very
oh, wait.
Interesting.
Did we?
No, we,
no, what did we, do?
We destroyed Dennick with Urtai.
Oh, to draw a card.
To draw a card, yeah.
So then that's definitely I need to find more cards because there's no land in hand?
Yeah, or more impactful cards at least.
Oh, boy.
Because there was the option to just Urtai away the shark.
Shark, yeah.
But it did play into maybe a possible make disappear. No, the blue mana was tapped. So,
yeah,
just an interesting sequence.
Okay.
And here is the layer of these good players. I was mm-hmm. kind of talking how Go for the Throat is not great, but the players do have access to the sideboard, and they actually get better postboard because the sharks are coming in. Mm. So you need to leave some in there. So JED on top of that sideboarding strategy.
Yeah, Go for the Throat, the most played card this weekend.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, and in plenty of tournaments, you know, playing standard leading up to the World Championship.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much just 2 mana kill anything.
Yeah.
With some exceptions.
I think close behind it was cut down, so, you know, just excellent spot removal, yep. cheap interaction. We saw it as being so important in the limited rounds as well yep. in this tournament.
Usually that's kind of how standard has worked in the past, is the removal is what guides what people can play.
Yep.
So the really good players, when you're kind of deck building for tournaments, they think, how can I play threats that play around the most played removal spells?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the people who do it correctly usually really have some success. And I mean, look at Greg's deck. You can't. I don't think Greg's ever played a cut downable target.
No.
Besides like a Mirex, you know?
Yeah.
Like I mean, you see the shark is a 2/4, the whales are 6/6s.
And usually anything that comes out of the shark in incubate form is above that threshold anyway.
Exactly.
So. Right, we're going to disturb Dennick, so Pious Apparition. Hits the battlefield. This is a flyer. Doesn't do anything about graveyards, but does care when a creature is put in there. So
yep.
some extra card draw coming from that, if possible.
Exactly. And from anywhere. So, you know, yeah. discarding off Raphine, any of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's really, really cool with Raphine. Syncopate, though, says no thank you.
For the full value there, normally you see that X equals 4 syncopate, and then you draw a card,
no
but
beanstalks.
No beanstalks to be found, and you see this control deck just operating at a much slower, grindier level.
Yeah. Hey, there's three cards in his hand. You told me he never has less than six. You lied.
I didn't think you were going to call me out on that.
Hey, I called something into existence inadvertently, so you did too.
Guy can't make a joke in this booth, huh?
Destroy Evil, Iganjo, and Sunfall in hand. So three premium white removal spells for Greg Orange.
Yep. And it looks like Greg's just trying to get more value off that Sunfall, mm-hmm. and there is the value that is needed. So we'll see. I think Greg's pretty priced into not letting JED draw some cards, because yeah. just attacking for two and being able to loot away possibly two lands in hand mm-hmm. could be the big swing in this match. That could really, really be yeah. devastating.
So Destroy Evil taking care of Rafine, pays the ward. Only 2 points of damage coming across the line. Down to seven goes Greg Orange.
Double Sunfall now available, so I think at this point you're priced into casting one since yeah. you don't have double blue. One thing Greg would love to do is go, you know, play land six, be able to play the whale, you know, bait out a counter spell, and then untap and Sunfall if it gets countered, but unable to do it as his draw has been pretty awkward, and now all of a sudden this Sunfall has to resolve, otherwise we're heading to game five.
What an incredible matchup we have seen so far between these two players.
Okay. So Greg playing it more safe and just going for the Iganjo, going mm-hmm. to one. And not a legend, so you cannot protect it.
Goodness me.
Okay, now.
This is where the fun really starts, right? When the control player is at one life?
Yes, yes. So now Greg does have the second blue source, can play this main phase, but now any kind of thing sends us to the next game.
Make disappear, just poised, ready and waiting for the whale to make a splash, and unfortunately it missed the mark, so we're going to get a game five. Is this another reverse sweep incoming?
It easily could be. Let's see if Greg keeps an opening hand. Hasn't kept an opening hand in the post-board matches yet.
He does.
7-7.
Let's go. All right.
And that's double up the beanstalk. That is just a perfect way to start these games.
Excellent.
With other lands, the mana looks good. There's removal spells. Everything is kind of going on in Greg's hand that he wants to be doing. And that's not a Thalia.
That's not. That is Denik, Pious Apprentice down on the board. Those are two lands yep. off of the draws, though, for Greg Orange.
Yep. Not bad. Not bad. I mean, that deck does want to draw land. So Greg had the option of going up the beanstalk on this turn, mm-hmm. but has that syncopate, wants to just make sure Wedding Announcement and Rafine do not hit the yeah. battlefield this turn.
Those are the must-deal-with
yes.
permanents in Jean Emmanuel's list, in this Esper Legends list.
For sure.
Speak of.
Post-combat, Rafine.
Nice.
Very interesting.
Yeah, just in case, you know, there's a Odawara or something. Well, not Odawara, excuse me. Iganjo.
Yep, yep.
Because then, yeah, Jean Emmanuel's like, yeah, got him.
So there is white source number two. So now Wandering Emperor is available to just get nice. This out of here. And these were kind of how these games looked mm-hmm. for the first two games when Greg won, is just stick a Planeswalker, be proactive, and have JED having to blink first and not be the reactive one.
Yeah.
If Greg can make JED be proactive and play into all of his removal spells, that's exactly where he wants to be.
Shieldred, the Apocalypse hits the board now. This.
Hey.
Is a very threatening card on the battlefield here for Jean Emmanuel, and yes. Greg needs to deal with it.
And I don't see an answer to it right now. I see, like, up the beanstalk to be able to draw something, to find something,
yeah,
to
lay down arms. Do nothing without planes.
No, okay. So it looks like Greg is trying to maybe line up a turn where he could go end step, bounce Shieldred off Odawara. And just makes a 2-2 here. This Shieldred is going to be an extremely fast clock.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, all right. So gain and drain happening here now for Jean Emmanuel. Has managed to get Shieldred to stick. It's amazing. Every single time we've seen Lord Skitter hit the board, it's dead straight away. But Shieldred, yeah. nope. She's like, here, let me show you how it's done.
And right now, I just see Mirex, Odawara, two laydown arms, and not near enough planes.
There's only one planes, right?
Just one Spar's planes Gardens. Right now, yeah.
That'll get rid of Skrelf.
And, I mean, that's needed as well, but Greg's dream is a Leyline Binding, but even Leyline Binding here is kind of brutal because you draw two cards and lose four. But look at this. We didn't see an attack from Shieldred trying to play around a Gonjo. It wasn't there, so if JAD had perfect information, he would have attacked. So that might be a little glimmer of hope here for Greg.
So Skrelv is taken care of here.
Yep.
Courtesy of Laydown Arms, only for one at the moment. We need some more planes down here for Greg.
Yeah, and this game would look a lot different if Greg was at 10. If that Shieldred attacked, maybe Greg chumps, but you know, I like playing around that card because if Shieldred lives, you're probably going to win in the long game. Yeah. But if you know it's not there, you'd much rather get in 4 damage, 8 damage, stuff like that.
Here comes Thalia joining Shieldred on the board here for Jean-Emmanuel.
Yep. And now we're probably going to see the end step Odawara on Shieldred? No.
No, just going straight to the draw.
That's very surprising.
Oh, wow. This hurts for Greg. Yeah. He's at 12. 29 is Jean-Emmanuel's life total.
So has to pay 2 for that.
Yeah. 2 planes.
Yep. Still fine. Can still Odawara.
Mm-hmm. So that gets rid of Thalia.
Yep.
Removing the tax on Greg Orange's hand. But again, that Laydown Arms is absolutely doing nothing at the moment.
Yeah.
So it's Odawara or bust at this point.
Exactly.
But then it just comes back and, oh boy.
Needs 2 planes to have that Laydown Arms actually deal with Shieldred.
Yeah, 2 more planes.
Exactly.
So, you know, Greg's probably just waiting for a board wipe at this point or March of Otherworldly Light, something to that effect that's a permanent answer because otherwise it's just coming back down next turn.
Yeah, and I wouldn't be too shocked if JAD has a counterspell at this point. This game's went on for a while. He hasn't cast one.
So clock is ticking here for Greg Orange.
One more planes. And this game would look so different if Shieldred kept getting in there.
Yeah, for sure. But, you know, Jean-Emmanuel is such a disciplined player.
Yeah.
We're going to see Takanuma abandon Meyer now. Milling a couple cards.
Urtai looks quite good there.
It does indeed. So that's going to come back.
And that was a blind Takanuma there with every other threat that was exiled. And that would say a couple things to me if I was playing against JAD. I would think that, yeah, you probably don't have any flash threats in hand, but you probably have other reactive cards like Disdainful Stroke, Negate, something like that that I have to be worried about. And now you have Urtai as well.
Yeah, Urtai back up for anything that may target Shieldred. Yep. So Jean-Emmanuel very close to closing out this game here. A reverse sweep, even.
The second one.
In our quarterfinals. Unbelievable stuff here from these players. But Greg, don't count him out. He's going to keep making these mites. 36-10. Let's see if he can find anything to get him back into this.
So
oh, my gosh.
Up the beanstalk. Up the beanstalk off the top. And now this is kind of brutal. Let's say this up to beanstalk finds a sunfall. All of a sudden, up the beanstalk originally puts Greg down to 6. Sunfall would kill Greg with the Shieldred triggers. So, like, couldn't even find that.
Oh, goodness.
At some point, Greg has to decide, I have to Odawara, bounce Shieldred, and then start drawing cards. Like, look at this. Can't even play up the beanstalk right now. Shieldred's going the distance.
She sure is. Wow. Shieldred. Jean-Emmanuel's favorite card right now, no doubt. She has just put in so much work just sitting on the board, not doing anything, watching Greg Orange's life total diminish.
Yeah, you know when Greg saw that card get spoiled, be like, lose life every time you draw a card? Oh, no. I like to do that.
Oh, getting in there with Thalia. So we're trying to accelerate the clock here for Jean-Emmanuel. He wants to get this over and done with.
Yep.
An advance to face Anthony Lee in the semifinals.
Okay, here it is. Finally having to Odawara.
Yeah.
Greg has been very patient with this card, and now this leads me to think that it's like, okay, next turn I just want to go crazy with this, but there's the Urtai to counter this.
So Shieldred sticks around. Urtai is there. He gets a card, which also triggers Shieldred, so he's down to 6.
And down to 4 at the draw step. Can't cast Sunfall. Can't cast any other big spells or up the beanstalk. We'll finish him off. Greg might have to draw a Plains.
Yeah, he...
A planes to deal with Shieldred with the lay down arms.
Yeah.
And even that has to hope that there's not a negate or something like that, too.
I mean, it's got Broker's Charm, but that doesn't do anything right now except kill him. There's no enchantment to target. There's no creature big enough to kill Shieldred. Oh, my.
So this is just a might to deal with Urtai?
Yeah. So it gives a plus one and deals damage equal to its power, so Urtai will be killed. Unless JED has something to say about it, but...
And JED can't really have anything right now, because the Thalia is taxing him as well,
yeah,
so
sure.
It's just one drops for JED. Could have channel lands. That's really all JED can have right now. And I did get a quick glimpse. I saw a disdainful stroke in hand for JED, but uncastable.
Yeah. Thalia giveth and Thalia taketh away. What did we find for Greg Orange? Can
Wandering
he
Emperor.
Stabilize?
Wandering Emperor, and another reason why JED has been holding back Shieldred, it's not a tap mm-hmm. creature for Wandering Emperor. So JED not attacking with this Shieldred at all.
So disciplined.
Very disciplined. The first couple turns with perfect information, maybe not the correct play, but it is just the correct play based on if this stays untapped, it's going to win the game. So really, really well played game from JED so far.
Let's see if this game reaches its conclusion, what Greg Orange can do, if anything, to get back into it. Oh, he's going for the Beanstalk.
Up to
We're going to draw to see what can we find. Is it anything of relevance right now? Oh, my.
Three mana. What did we draw? Is it the Plains?
Chromehost Seed Shark. Okay.
Hey.
Doesn't help, though.
But here's one mana. This has to cost two with Thalia attacks.
Yeah.
And this is just to gain three.
But it's uncostable, right?
No, Greg already cast one.
Oh, sorry, already
one.
Paid one. Okay.
So Greg goes to five. JED has Go for the Throat here. Go for the Throat on the shark, attack, win.
And that is going to do it. An unbelievable reverse sweep for Jean-Emmanuel Duprat up against a formidable foe in the face of Greg Orange. Unbelievable stuff, Corey.
Yeah, wow. The reverse sweep, you could really tell these post-board game made JED's deck a lot better. And that was just a game of Leyline Bindings were nowhere to be found to be able to deal with that Shieldred. And if Greg could have dealt with that Shieldred early, there was not enough pressure to really close that game out. So Shieldred MVP there, and Greg's different removal spells not lining up properly is going to send him packing, but still a great result for Greg Orange.
Unbelievable stuff. Well, we're going to go and hear from Jean-Emmanuel right now. He's with Cedric.
Jean-Emmanuel Duprat, you have just finished a marathon affair where you started down 0-2 against Pro Tour 25th anniversary champion Greg Orange, and you came all the way back.
Yeah, I'm still shaken right now. Like, it didn't go to plan at all. I lost the both games on the play where I'm supposed to have an edge, and then I had to win three on the draw after board where my Thalias are worse. Like, it seemed pretty much impossible, but I did it.
Well, you've clearly just done the impossible. What were you able to do in that third, fourth, and fifth game to claw back when you're not in the play, your Thalias are worse, and you generally just feel like you're worse in the matchup?
So the thing about Greg's deck is that he doesn't have that much card advantage. It's pretty much up the Beanstalk, and that's it. So if he doesn't draw up the Beanstalk, we one for one each other a lot. And like, if you manage your cards well, you can pull ahead even in the late game. You're allowed to play very long games even if it's a control deck. And the other thing is there's a dance between Sharks and Go for the Throats. In the rounds, he brought in the Sharks and beat me with it. Before the top eight. So I decided to keep in a small number of Go for the Throats, and they have been very good here.
Well, an amazing, amazing comeback. You've been in positions like this before. You've made deep runs in World Championship before. I'm excited to see you play again. I hope you think your deck well positioned now that you got past that one.
I really like my deck. I liked it in this matchup too. So like, as long as I don't face Esper Midrange, which is a very tense matchup where anything can happen, I'm happy about all the matchups.
Well, we're looking forward to watching you play. JED, good luck.
After the break, our final quarterfinal, Kazunek Asaka versus Willy Adel. Who will it be?